فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى today بإذن الله الكريم we're going to start the explanation on this book دفع إيهام للضراب عن آيات الكتاب. We're going to بإذن الله الكريم start to explain this book دفع إيهام للضراب عن آيات الكتاب. And this book is written by الشيخ العلامة محمد الأمين ابن محمد المختار ابن عبد القادر الشنقيطي رحمه الله. الشنقيطي رحمه الله. Who was born the year 1325 and he رحمه الله he died the year 1393. So inshallah تعالى this is the book which we will be going through. Today inshallah تعالى what we're going to do What we're going to do بإذن الله الكريم is explain or speak about the biography of the author, summarized and speak about him inshallah ta'ala. And then بإذن الله الكريم we'll be speaking about this book and the science that it deals with. And inshallah ta'ala the methodology of the author in this book and issues pertaining to it, inshallah ta'ala. Now this is a book, really in its original essence, it's something, a book you will really not find maybe, and no one explaining it in the English language. And even those who've explained it in the Arabic language, they've really explained it as though it was a ta'liq, as though it's just, they pointed it out here and there. But you won't find a detailed, word for word explanation. And that is inshallah what we hope to do in this explanation inshallah ta'ala is to explain this book in word for word inshallah ta'ala what it means and what the author intends by it inshallah ta'ala. The author of this book, his name is Al-Shaykh Muhammad Al-Amin Ibn Muhammad المختار ابن عبد القادر الجكني الشنقيطي. This name الجكني, this name الجكني is from the نسل, is from the tribe of جاكن. That's the people he is from. الأبري. And it's a قبيلة, a tribe whose lineage go back to حميري. He's an Arab then. He's an Himyari, he's a tribe of the Arabs. Rahimahullah. He was born in Mauritania, Rahimahullah. And the year he was born was, the Islamic calendar was 1325. And in the Gregorian calendar, it is 1907. He was born 1907. He studied in his land, Mauritania. Rahimahullah wa ta'allama biha. His father died. Wa tufiya waliduhu wa huwa saghir. His father died whilst he was a young boy. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti rahimahullah, after studying in his land and gaining a lot of knowledge, he became a teacher. واستقر مدرسا في المدينة النبوية. He became a teacher in the Islamic University of Medina. The Islamic University of Medina. He became a teacher there, and he also became a teacher in the Prophet's Masjid. The first time he came and he used to teach in the Prophet's Masjid when he first came, and then he started to teach in Riyadh, and then he came back to Medina, and when he came back to Medina, he started to teach at the University of Medina. The year in which he taught it was the year 1381. When he came back from Riyadh and he started to teach in the University of Medina, he also used to teach at that particular time, he used to teach in the Prophet's Masjid. He finished the Quran twice from beginning to end. He finished it. And on the third attempt, he rahimahullah he died before finishing it. وَتُوفِيَ دُونَ إِكْمَالِ الثَّالِثَةِ. Before he could finish the third time he wanted to finish it, he died. This noble Imam, rahimahullah, he has a lot of works and a lot of books in which he writ. And we're going to divide the works he has written into two. Books he wrote before he even came to Saudi Arabia. In other words, books that he wrote whilst he was in his land. He, rahimahullah, he wrote poetry, Nadm fi Ansab al-Arab. He wrote poetry on the Arab lineage. The Arab, their lineages. And this he wrote it when he was young. He wrote it, وَقَدْ كَتَبَهُ صَغِيرًا. He wrote this when he was one, when he was young. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd mentions in his kitab Tabaqatul Nassabin. Rahimahullah, Sheikh Bakr, who's a student of Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti, mentions this. That he wrote a book in the poetry, he wrote a poetry about the Arab lineages. You know what's funny or amazing? Is that he wrote it and he was young in age. And when he grew older, he buried this book. He got rid of it. And so they asked him, why have you buried it? Why did you get rid of it? And he said, I wrote it with no intention. When I first wrote it, I was writing it to compete with my peers. I was competing with them. I wanted to pass them. That is why I writ it. I didn't write it with any good intention. So he buried it. They begged him not to, but he buried it. His teacher said to him, don't bury it. Now perfect your intention. But he refused. He wrote also a little rajaz fi furu' madhab al-malikiyya, in the Maliki madhab. He wrote a small little book in it. He also has a poetry on the fara'id, inheritance. And he also wrote 1,000 lines fi ilm al-mantiq, in logic. Pay attention. You know what he said about himself? He said, I've never studied ilm al-mantiq. I never studied logic. Muhammad Amir Shaqirti said this. I've never studied it. But he was able to write 1,000 lines on it. This shows you his brain and his mind. Those were the books, ما ألفه ببلاده, that which he authored in his own land. Those were the books he wrote in his country. ما ألفه, now we're going to mention the second type, which is the books in which he wrote بعد استقراره في بلاد الحرمين. The books in which he wrote after he resided in the Haramain, Mecca and Medina. Or in the Arab Peninsula. He wrote the kitab الرحلة إلى بيت الله الحرام. He wrote a book where he talks about his journey to the Kaaba. He also has a book called منع جواز المجاز في المنزل للتعبد والإعجاز, which is connected to this kitab of ours that we're reading right now, دفع إهام للضراب عن آيات الكتاب دار عالم الفوائد. They published it with it, and it's at the end. And if we get time, inshallah ta'ala, we may also do that book, inshallah ta'ala. And that book, it talks about that there is no majaz in the Quran. the Quran does not consist of it, no similes or metaphors. The Quran, it has no metaphors or no similes in it. So he, rather, Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shaqir also proves that it's not even in the Arabic language. He also wrote this book of ours that we're reading right now. He wrote Daf'u Ihamil al-Dirab an Ayat al-Kitab. He also has Adab al-Bahth wal-Munadara. Adab al-Bahth wal-Munadara. And if you look at Adab al-Bahth wal-Munadara, the way he wrote it is as though Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti took the Khulasa and the book of Al-Akhdari in the Kitab al-Sulam al-Munawraq fi ilm al-Mantiq. Also he has an explanation on the book Qawa'id al-Usul wa Maqa'id al-Fusul. He also has a sharh on Maraqi al-Su'ud li Mubtaghi al-Ruqi wa-Su'ud. He has a sharh on it. Which is called Nathru al-Bunud. It's called Nathru al-Wurud, sorry. He called it Nathru al-Wurud. He has a sharh on Maraqi al-Su'ud. He also has his Adwa'u al-Bayan fi Idah al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an. And he reached up to Qawluhu Ta'ala, the speech of Allah, Ula'ika Hizbullah, ala inna Hizballahi humul ghalibu, ala inna Hizballahi humul muflihun, Surah Al-Mujadala, Ayah 22. أولئك حزب الله ألا إن حزب الله هم المفلحون. He reached up to that ayah and he stopped there. He died. And his student, his obedient student, الشيخ عطيه سالم, he carried it on and he finished it. He finished off the أضواء البيان. He also has little other رسائل which he has written, little other books that he has written. He has a book called منهج ودراسات لآيات الأسماء والصفات. He has a book on Asma'i wa Sifat. So this is the answer to your question. Has he written a book in Aqeedah? Na'am, he has written this book. He also has a book called Hikmatu Tashri', the wisdom behind legislation. The Tashri' of the Quran and the Sunnah. He also has a risala over behind what? Al-Yawma Akmaltu Lakum Deenakum Wa Atmamtu Alaykum Ni'mati. He has a Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, who is the student of a Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti. By the way, Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, who is the one who's speaking about Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti, was a udu. He was a member of the Committee of Scholars of Saudi Arabia. He was a udu of Hayat Kibar al-Ulama, and he was also a udu of the Lajna al-Daima. Bakr Abu Zayd, with Ibn Baz. Bakr Abu Zayd was sitting with Ibn Baz. Sheikh Salah al-Fawzan, and the Mufti, who right now is the Mufti, and Sheikh Ibn Jibreen, and They were udu, a member of the committee. The vice of the committee was Abdul Razak al-Afifi. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd was an elite person at that level. And his teacher was Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti. Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti was his teacher. Look what he said about his teacher, Muhammad Amin al-Shanqiti. He said, لو كان في هذا الزمان أحد, if this time there was anyone أحد يستحقه deserves أن يسمى بشيخ الإسلام. If there is anyone who deserves to be called شيخ الإسلام, ابن شيخ الإسلام of this time, لكان هو. It would have been for محمد الأمين الشنقيطي. If anyone deserved this time to be called شيخ الإسلام, it would be him. الشيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي, brothers and sisters, توفي الشيخ الأمين الشنقيطي بمكة. He died in Mecca. And he died ضحى. At ضحى, يوم الخميس, on a Thursday. السابع عشرة. And it's the 17th of the month, ذي الحجة. He died in the month, ذي الحجة. When the year was what? 1,393 Islamic Hijriya. And in the Gregorian calendar, it was 1,973. In other words, 1973, he died. وَغُسِّلَ فِي بَيْتِي فِي مَكَّةِ, and he was washed in his house in Mecca. In his house in Mecca, which used to be in Shari' Mansur. He was washed. وَصَلَّى عَلَيْهِ الشَّيْخ عَبْدِ الْعَزِيزِ إِبْنُ بَازِ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ بَعْدَ صَلَاةِ الظُّهْرِ. And Shaykh Ibn Baz led the janazah of his after Salat al-Dhuhr in the Haram. He led it. ودفن and he is buried and was buried بمقبرتي in the janazah place of Al-Ma'lati in Mecca. The Sheikh's biography and his personality and how he was as an individual and how aesthetic he was. مما لا يفيء به هذا المقام. This time of ours will not give it justice. If we try to talk about it, we will not be able to make you understand the value and this individual's mind and his brain. رحمه الله تعالى. But if you really want to go further and want to read into his life and understand a bit more about him, if you look at the muqaddimah of Adwa'ul Bayan, his student of his, Atiyah Salim, spoke about his teacher and explains it and talks about the things that took place between him. Also, if you read the mu'allafat, the books of Bakr ibn Abdullah Abu Zayd, you will see he mentions a bit about him. Especially the kitab that we're currently teaching right now, Hilyatu Talib al-Ilm, by Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, we've came across when we were talking about qana'ah, contentment. And the student of knowledge should be content. He mentions the story of his teacher, Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti, when he came to Saudi Arabia. He said that I have come from my land, Shanqit, with a treasure that majority of the people don't possess. And then he said, what it is that I am content. I am a person who's content. And he was like that. It was said that Sheikh Muhammad Amin al-Shanqit, rahimahullah, he would go to a shop. And he would go to the owner of the shop and say to him, here's your money. After we'd buy whatever he wanted to buy, he would buy. And he would give his money. He would give his money to the owner of the shop and say, take whatever is yours. He didn't know the difference between the rialat, the different types. He didn't know. And he's an individual, my beloved brothers and sisters, who he said that he memorized Lisan al-Arab. It's a qamus, a dictionary. كان يستحضرها. He used to have استحضار of it. He would quote it, his brain. But when it came to the worldly matters, when it came to this dunya, he had no raghba, desire, wanted to know about it. That is the type of person he was, الشيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي رحمه الله تعالى. What is the name of this book that we're studying? The name of this book is دَفْعُ إِهَامِ لِلْضْرَبْ عَنْ آيَاتِ الْكِتَابِ. And the author himself clearly stated that that's the name of his book. صرح الشنقيطي محمد الأمين الشنقيطي رحمه الله تعالى, he clearly stated the name of his book. And he said this in the مقدمة, we're going to see it soon inshallah تعالى, which he says, I have called my book دَفْعُ إِهَامِ لِلْضْرَبْ عَنْ آيَاتِ الْكِتَابِ. So let us explain what this means. Because a lot of the times students are carrying a big book. Big, fat, heavy book, they're carrying it. But if they ask who is the author of this book, they don't know. Okay, what is the name of the book? They don't know. What is this book talking about? They even, a lot of them don't have a good understanding of the book. So why are you carrying it if you don't understand it? مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاةَ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُوا أَسْفَارًا. The person becomes like a donkey who books are placed on. So it's important to understand and have a good understanding of the book that you're going to read. Have a very good perception of it. The author himself, what is he going to deal in this book? What is the name of the book before you embark on knowing the content of the book? صح. So the name of the book, we have to explain it. The first part is دفع. دفع means to repel. It is to remove. It is to repel and remove. إيهام. إيهام is a مصدر, is a verbal noun. And it comes, the Arabs, they say, أوهم غيره إيهاما. أي جعله يتوهم. أي يظن. It means to repel the doubts, the speculation, the assumption, So it is, إيهام means is a مصدر, and it is أوهم غيره إيهاما, أي جعله يتوهم, أي يظن, is to think or to assume something. Some of the scholars, I'm going to come to it later, some of the scholars, they actually critiqued him for using this word. الشيخ محمد أمين الشنقيطي اعترض عليه بعض المعاصرين. Some of the contemporary scholars, they showed disagreement in the usage of this word إيهام. And the reason why they said is because خشية أن يكون في هذا نسبة نقص إلى بيان القرآن. They said that this may show a deficiency in the clarification of the Quran. People may think to themselves that the Quran has speculation and doubt in it, and that it requires repelling. And Sheikh Muhammad Al-Amin Al-Shaqiti, in response to those individuals and defending the Sheikh Rahimahullah, we say that the Sheikh Rahimahullah, he was not أول من يقول, the first person to say this. He wasn't the first. Rather, before him, you will find that Zarkashi, you will find that Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, you will find before him Ibn Aqilata, you will find Al-Qinnuji. Al-Qinnuji is who? Muhammad Siddiq Hassan Khan. وغيرهم, and other than them, they all what? They all alluded to the usage of this word. ولذلك الإمام الشوكاني also the same when it came to the in his فتح القدير in the second volume page 113 قوله تعالى بجناحيه he said لدفع الإيهام لأن العرب تستعمل الطيران لغير الطير كقولهم طر في حاجتي also الألوسي in his روح المعاني so scholars have previously used it. The second response to that, it is that the assumption and the doubt is not in and within the Quran. No. It is according to the deficiency of the reader or the person who is trying to ponder on the Quran. So the speculation and the doubt that is being removed is not what's in the Quran. It is your deficiency or your lack of comprehension of the Quran. The second point that we need to realize about the definition of the book is first we took what the daf means, we took iham, and then the word iddirab. Iddirab lughatan, iddirab linguistically, it comes min al-darbi with alif al-lam. Al-darbi, not a fi'il. Al-iddirab ay min al-darbi, which is an ism, not a fi'il. So there's an alif al-lam, and the dad has a shadda on it. يُقَالُ it says, تَضَارَبَ الْقَوْمُ وَضَّرَبُوا ضَرَبَ بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا It means, when people, they hit one another, and they collide with one another. So in other words, الضراب is close in terms of meaning with اختلاف and تناقض. It means when the verses are hitting each other and they're contradicting and they're bumping into each other. Which is إذ هو ضرب بعض الآيات بعضا. Some of the verses are hitting the other verses. So why did the Shaykh rahimahullah use the same meaning? دفعوا. Yeah, why would he say دفعوا إيهام للضراب? If إيهام and الضراب are the same meaning, what was the significance of him bringing it? We will say, اختارهُ لِلسَّجْعَةِ The reason why he brought it is the rhythm and the flow that it has. دَفْعُ إِهَامِ لِلضِّرَابِ الضِّرَابِ goes hand in hand with what? الْكِتَابِ So it rhymes when you say, دَفْعُ إِهَامِ لِلضِّرَابِ عَنْ آيَاتِ الْكِتَابِ الضِّرَاب finishes with أَلِفًا بَاء and كِتَاب finishes with أَلِفًا بَاء So there's that سَجْعَ there. And the fourth thing that we need to mention, which is دفع إهام للضراب عن آياتي آيات the Sheikh رحمه الله when الشيخ عطية سالم, الشيخ عطية سالم, he mentions in the biography of the Sheikh, if you go to أضواء البيان, and he, when he's mentioning the books of the Sheikh, he says عن آي الكتاب instead of عن آيات الكتاب, he says عن آي الكتاب, which is جمع التكسير, جمع قلة. So here the question is, and also if you look at the كتاب عذب النمير, the عذب النمير, which is also a تفسير of the Sheikh, and Dr. Khalid al-Sabt is the one who brought it together, he also brings it as آي الكتاب. And others, when they translated or they mentioned his biography, they did that. Also, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, he, in his Usul al-Tafsir, he brings it as an آي الكتاب. And the reason we say this from them is just leniency in usage. No problem. As long as it means the same. This is not a دليل قال الله قال الرسول. So this is a form of what? تسمح, some leniency from their side. Like in the Sheikh, he himself named the book. And when he named it, he says, آيات. We'll see that inshallah ta'ala very soon. That is what he called it. And آيات, my beloved brothers and sisters, is verses. And I have seen some people said, it is not good to translate آيات as verse. I've seen some people say that in the English language. Like in those of you who know, inshallah, if you can research more into this, is verse correct to translate as an ayah in English? Though some of those people who know it said to me, it's not good to do. So what do we do? Ayat is what the Sheikh chose, which is not jam'u al-taksir, jam'u al-mu'annath al-salim. And it is, as I said before, is min jumu' al-qillah. It's from the jumu' al-qillah. And the Sheikh, rahimahullah, in many of his, in many places of his book, Adwa'ul Bayan, he brings it as ayat as well. Not just here, but many places, he brings it like that. Also, what's amazing is, al-Shaykh Atiyah Salim himself, when he carried on Adwa'ul Bayan, he also brought it with the wording of ayat as well. Ala kulli hal, the name is An Ayat al-Kitab. So now we know what the book is about. And we're going to explain more, inshallah ta'ala, about it. Why did the author write this book for? سبب تأليف الكتاب. Why did he author the book for? And understanding why he authored the book will also help us understand the book properly. الشيخ عطية السالم, he explains and he tells us why. He mentions it, رحمه الله. الشيخ عطية السالم. He says, رحمه الله. رحمه الله. He says, وقد كان سببه التوفيق بين قوله تعالى وقفوهم إنهم مسؤولون ما لكم لا تناصرون مع قوله تعالى فيومئذ لا يسأل عن ذنبه إنس ولا جان. الشيخ رحمه الله, these two verses, the first verse is in سورة الصافات آية 24 to آية 25, and the second one is in سورة الرحمن آية 39. These two verses, the Shaykh rahimahullah, and I'm not going to explain it because it's going to come to us in this book. The first one, which is وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْئُولُونَ مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَنَاصَرُونَ, and the other one, وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْئُولُونَ وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْئُولُونَ مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَنَاصَرُونَ, and the other one, which is فَيَوْمَئِذٍ لَا يُسْأَلُ عَنْ ذَنْبِهِ إِنْسٌ وَلَا جَانٌ. When it came to these two verses, and the ظاهر استعارض, from the apparent, it seems as though it's contradicting. The Shaykh tried to reconcile between the two. And he went into very good explanation of how to reconcile it. And he brought many examples for it, as Muhammad Atiyah Salim says. فَأَجَابَ الشَّيْخُ بِاسْتِفَاضَةٍ وَذَكَّرَ لَهَا أَمْثِلَةً عَدِيدَةً. And the Shaykh gave a lot of examples in the answer that he gave. فَسَأَلْتُ عَنْ تَأْلِيفٍ فِيهَا. Atiyah Salim said, I asked him then, is there any book written that speaks about these topics like this? About verses that seem to contradict. Is there a book out there that seems to have, that we can read and we can see these things from? And the Shaykh rahimahullah said, لا أعلمه. I don't know it. I mean, I don't know if it exists. فكان رجائي منه أن يؤلف فيه. And he said, from that I wished and I hoped and from the Shaykh that he would write a book in this. لنفع المسلمين, so he can benefit the Muslims. فوعد خيرا. The Shaykh said, inshallah, hope for khair. inshallah khair will come from it, don't worry. ثم فعل, and then the sheikh did it. He stood up and he authored this book of his. So this book came from what, my beloved brothers and sisters? It came from this questioning and the need of the students. And this brings us to this issue, which is one of the reasons why scholars write books. A lot of the times you see what? Huh? People asking. Like Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, his muqaddimah fi usul al-tafsir. Yeah? He wrote it from a question. A person asked him. He's aqidatul wasatiyah, the same. That's one way. Shaykh Muhammad al-Amin al-Shaqiqi, rahimahullah. He wrote his book because he was asked. And sometimes, what is it? Sometimes no one asks him, but the situation of that time and whatever is happening, it requests from him to write a book in it. He, for example, sees riba spreading, or he sees zina spreading, or he sees the land is full of shirk. So what does the scholar do? The scholar comes out and he writes a book in it. He writes a book in this particular field. He writes a book in the particular field. And who asked him this time? The hal. So he says, we say, he wrote it بسؤال الحال. The situation asked him to write a book. It's as though the situation came up to him and said to him, it's about time you spoke about me. And sometimes, no, it is a person comes up to the sheikh and says, sheikh, we need this from you, and the sheikh writes a book. The sheikh, rahimahullah ta'ala, when did he write the book? In other words, time exactly. And how long and the duration of his writing of this book? And where was he when he wrote this book? The Sheikh rahimahullah, he wrote this book, Daf'u Iham al-Dirab. He wrote it in 15 nights. Fi khamsa asharata laylatan, 15 nights he wrote this whole book. And he wrote it in the summer holidays, when the year was 1373. The Sheikh wrote it. And he wrote it in the city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Madinat al-Nabawiyyah. And we're gonna, the Sheikh mentions that at the end of the book, that he wrote it in Medina. Now that we spoke about some of his books that he has written, where does this book actually fall in between all the other works of his? Is there any books that you can say it was in between those books, or while he was writing this one, he was also doing another book? So we can have a better understanding, because it's important for us. Does some of his opinions, did they change, or was he, huh? Or etc. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he transmitted from this book of his, Daf'u Iham al-Dirab, in his book Adwa' al-Bayan, more than 80 times he transmits from his kitab Daf'u Iham al-Dirab in his book Adwa' al-Bayan, more than 80 times. And he also transmits from it in his Mudakkira fi Usul al-Fiqh, only one time. And also in his Rihla, he transmitted in it his Daf'u al-Iham, rahimahullah. This book, what does it deal with? What does it tackle? And why was it written for? The Shaykh rahimahullah, and we already spoke about the name of the book. So by knowing the name of the book, we already understand what the book is going to be dealing with. The Shaykh rahimahullah, the book here, he wrote it for what? Ar-raddu, to refute. Ala awham al-ikhtilaf wa-tanaqud fi al-Qur'an al-Kareem. The some assumptions and the speculation and the doubt that some have with them in believing that the Quran contradicts itself and that there are contradictions in the Quran. And this science, which is knowing how to repel the contradictions that some may try to bring regarding the Quran, the definition that was given to it is as follows. It is a ilmun, it's a science. الذي يبحث this science in it أما يبحث فيه in this science a person researches or the science researches itself what does it research في النصوص القرآنية Quranic texts التي يتوهم من ظاهرها التعارض those texts from its apparent contradiction is seen from it or assumed from it that contradiction whether it's in the wording سواء كان ذلك في اللفظ whether that is in the wording or will معنى or it's in the meaning doesn't matter is to repel and to remove. This science is a science that researches textual verses, ayat in the Quran, that when you look at it from the apparent, they seem to contradict one another. Those contradictions that seem to be there can either be in the wording of the ayah, or it can be in the meaning of the ayah. It's to repel it. By doing what? By repelling that doubt. In explaining the أوجه الجمع, the way to bring it together and to reconcile it. That is what the science is about. And as we all know, the Quran is crystal clear. The Quran has no contradiction in it. But the problem is in the individual who's trying to read the Quran. ولذلك the poet he said, وَكَمْ مِنْ عَائِبٍ قَوْلًا صَحِيحًا وَآفَتْهُ مِنَ السَّفَهْمِ السَّقِيمِ